Well, thanks for staying with us on the program this morning as we begin our newspaper review more in-depthly. We're joined by an economic analyst and a public affairs analyst as well, Dr. Aliyu Elias. Good morning to you, sir.
Good morning, and thank you for having me.
Now, one of the prominent issues we looked at that is making headlines with mixed reactions from Nigeria is the position of ex-presidents and governors at the Council of State meetings held in the State House in Abuja yesterday.
Right.
Where, despite some absences in former President Olusegun Obasanjo and IBB, the ex-presidents seem to have united in a vote of confidence for President Bola Tinubu. Let's get your thoughts on this.
Right. I think it's much more of a media frenzy because, you know, there's no way, if you recall, none of those past presidents came out to actually see what they say. And those that are handling the president are the ones that came out to see what they say. So if they had even scolded the president, they would not even still come out and say, oh, they said there's problem. But it's quite glaring that Nigeria is in much challenge. And that's why there's need to call for that meetings. So without even saying it out, it shows that Nigeria is in a bit of a frenzy and challenges. You see protests that we have not been seen before. We see hunger that we have not seen before. So they will not come out and said, you know, they are statesmen and they are very mature. So, and they have actually done their time and there are challenges. You recall during Buhari, there was a challenges. During Jonathan too, there was challenges. Let's not talk about Gowon and Co. because it was more of military era and it has to do with obey the last command. But during those people, they have challenges too. So what I think is that they must have told him indoor that, gentlemen, this thing is going the way we Nigeria will not appreciate. However, look for a way of solving the problem. So I think they actually told him things that will maybe that you need to do. But the handlers, the Lealaki, you know, the minister, those that come out to say, they wouldn't say the negative that, oh, they told the president that he should quickly work on CNG, he should quickly work on. They will say they are passing vote of confidence on him. So I think it is expected.
Now, whilst you have made some case as to the media not being entirely privy to certain strong words that have been said yesterday, the handlers of the presidency, let's look at some of the statements they have made and the perspectives they greeted. This Day newspaper earlier published that Mr. Dele Alake had made a strong statement asking all those who are crucifying the current administration just 14 months of having been in office to wait until 2027. It says, and I quote, "Anyone not satisfied with our government should wait for next election to cast their votes," unquote. Now many say that having a notion like this would confuse the current administration of knowing what is politically correct and what is democracy driven in terms of opposition and their view.
It's quite disappointing to hear from Dele Alake, a reputable journalist, a former commissioner of information and strategic communication, to come out and make such strong, unguided statement, I should say. Because if you look at that statement, it's just like to even put more problems. And that's why we have issues with handlers of the president. I can only exclude the minister of information, because if you look at minister, if at all you want to pass a message, there's a way we manage that statement, that in fact you want to reason with it. But look at Ononuga, look at Ajuri, look at even Dele Alake, you know, they are trying to hit the policy with their language. You know, you don't say we should wait till 2027 for anybody to actually contest against the president. We are saying currently now, while you are campaigning, there's some things you campaign with. And why you immediately you came into the office, you remove a subsidy, you know. And then you came into the office, all what you're supposed to do that had been planned by President Buhari in terms of CNG, you know, working of refinery, among other things, it did not work. So you are now coming out to say that statement. I'm sure he by now, because he's a strategic communicator, I wonder why he would lose guard to say that kind of message. So I'm sure he must have also reason to say that he shouldn't have. Perhaps he's not a spokesperson of the president. He's a minister of solid mineral. He should have managed his office not to come. Because I'm sure if he's a spokesman of president, by now the president would have been on him. Because I know the minister of information have understood how he should communicate with Nigeria. And he's managing it very well. But for that, I'd like to say, if you want, wait till 2027 to contest against him. I'm sure they would have called him to order by now.
Now, whilst we look at more persons who made notable comments that are captured by the newspapers this morning, another person also rightly captured who did not go in the line of 2027 but looked at the economy which has been the main decimal in this conversation, is the coordinating minister of the economy and minister of finance, Mr. Wale Edun, who rather painted an optimistic picture of some of the gains recorded by the current administration. And he was looking at key issues based on where the foreign reserve was before the administration came in, where it is now 14 months after, how much of FX backlogs have been cleared, how much of ways and means have been reduced in terms of government borrowing and whatnot. As an ardent economist yourself, listening to Mr. Wale Edun, would you say it's entirely an optimistic picture, and the hashtag end bad governance protests were largely politically motivated, as some are leading us to believe?
Right. I think, you know, you have to manage your optics when you are in government, because people listen to your body language and the way you are presenting. And another thing is that in a country like Nigeria, you need to manage people's intuition. You know, you need to tell people what you've been doing and positively what people should expect. I think that's what the minister is doing. I must agree with you that the minister is working very well. But the fact is that, you know, no matter what you put in place, the end result is what we want to see. Nigeria want better life, better live. You know, want to, if you cannot take us to a better place, leave us where actually met us. And that's the language of Nigerians now. Because now we believe that, in fact, we are preferring the government of Buhari in terms of economic indices, you know, the well-being of Nigeria, the cost of living, you know, standard of living, compared to now. So if you cannot give us, tell us what you have been doing. And that's a good one. And like what I said many times, that always tell Nigerians the good thing you have been doing. Then tell us where you are going to take us. Perhaps they even call this government Renew Hope. You know, so that hope is what we actually want. And Nigerians are people that want to listen to something positive. That want to say, okay, you have launched 20 CNG buses. NNPC have also come up with, NNPC Foundation has come up with 10. You know, these are the things we want to see. So by the time we see all this, you know, keep us telling us what we are expecting. And that will be gladdening. Not to see people like that, like we said, wait. You know, you are looking at the opposition at this point in time. We are talking about the economy and standard of living. I'm sure every Nigerian is clear to them that there is challenge in Nigeria economy. You know, we want to believe that in as much as we are convinced that Tinubu has good intention. Every president will always say they have good intent. But what we are saying is that what we are seeing on ground is not helping the economy. You know, you have declared state of emergency on food security. Up to now, food is still very, very, very expensive. In fact, I can tell you that people spend over 60% of their income to consume food, which is a serious issue. So if I have spent 60% of my income on food, what will I do with rent, you know, transportation, school fees, and other sundry, you know, expenses I have to incur? So these are the challenges we have. So we want something meaningful. Something, you know, that we can lay hand on, okay, with this also period. Perhaps, I always argue it, up till now, I have not seen President Tinubu economic agenda.
Blueprint.
You know, I've not seen the short term, I've not seen the medium term, I've not seen the long term. You know, all what they are doing is reactive, not being proactive. Maybe there's a problem here, okay, give them 10 billion for CNG. There's a problem here, give them palliative, you know. This thing, it's just intervention in nature. It cannot sustain us. And as an economist, we don't believe in those handouts, we call it. It will not last, because if you give us 100,000 in our house for 3 months, it will, if we buy anything within 2 months, it has finished. What will happen next? You know, and that's why we say, beyond paying those things, go and fix the CNG. If all transport, all truck drivers, all commercial drivers, even let's say 50% of them are on CNG, you know, by now it would have crashed the price of things down. Because the major drivers of this, very difficult economy, is the first subsidy remover. And there must be, a way of cushioning the effect so that it will not go beyond this.
You've rightly pointed out some things, and I'd like to look at it in line with what was published earlier on the first newspaper. The writer story on the first newspaper talked about the position of Catholic bishops to President Bola Tinubu, calling on him to rescue Nigerians from multidimensional poverty. You've cited one very important statistic, that at least 60% of most Nigerian household income is spent on food and consumption, despite the declaration of food emergency on the state of the food situation in Nigeria. You have said that some of the interventions for now are more like handouts and are not sustainable.
Right.
What would be one of the solutions you would advise the presidential coordinating committee to take in line with Rescue Nigeria from our position with regards to food crisis?
You know, I agree with the clergyman and the Catholic bishop. Honestly, they feel the pulse of people than every other people in political power. You know why? People find it easy to actually come to this religious leader to appeal to them. Perhaps they also see the hands that those people that are bringing things for the needy I find it even difficult to actually bring it for, down for the needy. That's a serious issue. And that shows that even the rich are also feeling this government in the negative way. So for me, I think those things need to be tackled as soon as possible. You know, when people are surviving a particular level and they are not surviving at that level, it brings serious issues. I can tell you, like even life expectancy, you know, by the time you don't have money to survive, you know, you have to cater for your three children, you can't cater. It's actually reduced even life expectancy of that asshole. And for them not feeding well, you know, it also adds negative implications. So if you look at all these things surrounding Nigerians, it simply boils down to what? Economy. And that's what part of the what our end bad governors came to talk about. And I'm sure government must have seen the hands that, you know, this bad government approach must be adjusted. And if you look at it, that's what bring about state council meetings. You know, it's because of the what has actually happened that brings about all the governors. And our seven governors actually say what they have been, you know, doing before those ex-presidents and chief judges. I mean, I saw Justice Begore too, you know, among all that other Nigerian leaders. So I think they, by now, they would have tell. That's why I said most thing they discuss is not what they would tell us in the media, because in fact, medias are not privy to it. It is what people came out to actually tell them that they would take. So I'm sure going forward, we'll see maybe a better Nigeria going forward.
Well, there are hopes that the picture in view, with much of the comments as made by the Minister of Finance and Coordinating Minister of Economy, Mr. Waledu, that the picture is optimistic, much like Dr. Aliyu has concurred to. But in keeping with more developments, following another perspective of some of the outcomes of the State Council meeting held yesterday, was a position of ex-governors and ex-presidents who viewed the hashtag End Bad Governance protest as a politically motivated one and a way to bring about an unconstitutional change in government. Now, this was earlier reported on the Daily Sun and the Daily Independent. Let's, for the sake of our viewers at home, pick them again and just remind you of the lead focus. It says, mass protest, no to unconstitutional change of government. Council of State berates protesters asking for Tinubu's oust, backs president. That's the position of the Daily Sun. Whilst on the Daily Independent, it is from the angle of the NSA in the straplines accompanying the lead story that the NSA reassures nobody would truncate hard-end democracy. Wait till 2027 election, FG tells President Tinubu's opponents. Now, it's been viewed more of a political outcome, and I think you're one of the persons in your earlier comments that disagreed that it's hunger that caused the protest. But now we're hearing that it's more of a politically motivated one, with the invitation to the military, which the military has also made a statement saying that there'll be no truncation of Nigeria's democracy.
Right. So if they say it's from it's politically motivated, I would disagree. You know what? I've not seen PDP coming out to give us their statements. In fact, for me, if you ask me, we're having a weak opposition. Up to now, remember, Atiku is one that bring about message. It's not PDP. There's a difference between that. Even up to now, Labour Party have not even shared us their opposition about this protest. It's maybe Obi that is actually talking. So I think that it's politically motivated is not correct, because it's clear that there's hunger. And hunger and poverty and insecurity, we could say it's the function. And if you ask me, look at the northern part of Nigeria. What brings about those level of, that, because we won't call that protest. We say maybe it's function of maybe their poverty and the level of education daring, because you can't see that in other places, in Port Harcourt, in maybe in Lagos. It's not to that level. Then for them to the issue of flag, I think that's what brought about that maybe they want to truncate or whatever. But if you look at that issue of flag, there's a lot of theory about it. You know, some theory says maybe some of them intend to bring Nigeria Army flag. Some even theory also say some of them want to, you know, because of what is happening in Nigeria, want to flag the Russian flag. But however, looking at it, anybody who bring about wrong flag, that is treasonable. I agree they should just arrest those such person and make sure that doesn't happen again. You recall even during the NSAS, upon the challenges, they still held the Nigerian flag. So I'm not in support of somebody who is holding another person's, another country flag. Too bad. But we should face the reality, and the reality is hunger. And there must be a quick fix about it. And even government actually alluded to that. And that's why President Bola Tinubu, as at 1 year ago, July 13, 2023, declared state of emergency. But our question is that if you declare state of emergency on food security, and we have not seen it, because when he declared it, I was expecting about three things: all-round year farming, that is through irrigation. I was expecting to also work on Nigerian food supply chain, whereby, you know, there is a way you cushion the effect of bringing food, because it's the major problem is that there is food in some places. For instance, if there's food in Bauchi, Sokoto, and what have you, I want to take that food down to Lagos, down to Ibadan, down to Abuja. Do you know how much you expended on transportation? That would have doubled the cost that you bought, purchased the food itself. And what would that bring? The seller would now push the cost to the consumers, and that's what bring about our food inflation.
Now, this is some of the prominent issues leading the outcome of the State Council meeting held yesterday. Now, whilst we leave that focus, it's important to point out that another decision many have applauded President Bola Tinubu for, on the one hand, in his quest to ensure judicial autonomy, has also been viewed by most Nigerians that are coming at the wrong time in terms of a call to cut down on the cost of governance. Now, whilst the judiciary is also one of the very primarily sensitive arms of government, a salary increase at this moment, in view of the one that was granted to Labour, has been quite the bane of conversations. Now, earlier reported on the leadership is a 300% pay raise for judicial officers and workers. Now, this is in a quest to bring about reforms in our judiciary. You've seen, on the one hand, claps; on the other hand, knocks. Where do you stand in all of this?
Right. I think I'm in support of a good salary for judiciary workers, because, you know, that's the hope of the common man. And, you know, everybody wants to go to the judiciary. If they are not well paid, you remember, they said if you don't pay well, a monkey will work for you. I don't know if you have get to hear that, because if you don't pay well, you won't get quality people to actually work for you, and there will not be that research. But let's look at where we are coming from. Let's a kind of a chronicle where we are coming from. You recall that President Buhari actually took a different president to court. You know, he contested three times, and he came out and said we have a bad judiciary system. And later he became the president. And when he became the president, remember, he actually during his time, a lot of judges house was ransacked. You remember that they would see military there. Is it on again? Justice on again or something that they have to look. I know he said they actually are corrupt. But coming in of President Bola Tinubu, now he now see reasons now that, okay, let them feed better. You recall that, I think, for Chief Justice of Nigeria, we'll be calling about 64 million naira or so. And other, you know, it will go to the grassroots. I think I'm in support of that. And it shouldn't stop at the top only. It should go around, because common, you know, magistrate courts, not even common, I mean, customary courts, you know, look at all those lower courts. All those who need better earnings. By the time they have better earnings, I think from there, the way they will, discharge their duties will be different. So I think it's quite deserving for me. However, you know, you look at it, 300% increment. Well, the fact remains that Labour has gotten their own, I think is what they bargained for, and which is 70,000 naira for minimum wage. Perhaps most of these judiciary workers, too, they are part of it. I don't know if their salary scheme is different, because, you know, if you still go to Supreme Court, you have administrative workers, other level. So are they going to benefit from 300 jumbo pay, or they will still be under 70,000? For me, I think it's a good thing, because if people earn better, I think by so doing. And you also see Governor Ododo yesterday of Kogi State also give 11 new vehicles to the state judges. I think that's a good one too, because if you want good outcome, you need to serve people very, very well. You know, good earnings always make people to perform better. In fact, if you look at Nigerian scenario, most people that complain more are people that earn less, because by the time you earn the particular level, you know, you want to discharge perhaps. Let's even look at the bribery. If you look at the a particular research by UN organization in collaboration
UNODC.
With UNODC with
corruption report,
exactly, with Nigerian Bureau of Statistics also.
Yes, of course.
They said the highest sector that is corrupt, they said is judiciary. Sure. So if you look at that side by side, you see that, well, for you to really tame this corruption in that area, because a lawyer will say some of them, so to say, will say, okay, you have to pay me well so that I can also service other people so as to make sure that you have the right thing. So I think if they are not being serviced, they are doing it honestly, you know, and, you know, in a way it's supposed to be, I think that would be fine, because justice is very, very key in Nigeria. If I look at a lot of political issues, and another thing I want the federal government to also look is that, you know, there's a way that some cases last for 4 or 5 years, you know, especially at Supreme Court. Maybe they should bring more judges. Maybe they should unbundle that area to have regional or whatever, so that, because a lot of cases are there waiting for their attention. But if you look at political issues, it's quick to be resolved. So I think it's key they pay them well and they also make them to work well. Because not only for them to receive pay, they should also do the job, as it were.
Now, Dr. Aliyu, citing the corruption survey conducted in 2023 and the patterns of corruption in Nigeria, especially with the demographics of those who received the most bribes, as reported in a report as published by UNODC and the National Bureau of Statistics, in collaboration with the MacArthur Foundation, has said that President Bola Tinubu's decision to hike the salary for judicial officers by 300% is a welcomed one, in line with the hopes for judicial autonomy and reforms that would strengthen the legal system in Nigeria. What's your take on it? Would like to know. Do also send in your comments and reactions as well. Now, leaving that topic and revisiting one of the highlight topics as published on the Punch newspaper, has also been more reports concerning the hashtag End Bad Governance protests. Now, we hear this morning, as we look at the front page again, the federal government has blocked some funds said to be linked with the sponsors of the protest and have arrested political collaborators. The headline reads, FG blocks 83 billion naira protest funds, arrests political collaborators. Government uncovers $50 million crypto funds, block 4 digital wallets containing $38 million. Police to declare foreign agents wanted, trace 4 billion naira to Kano, Abuja, Katsina political bigwigs. Now, it gets interesting anytime I see these publications, and I'll tell you why before I get your perspective. Anytime we're told by the media that arrests have been made by political sponsors, Nigerians always clamor to want to know the names of these persons. Many also say issues of state security can be better handled away from the eyes of the media. But we believe that justice to be seen, to be served and done. If the federal government has credible intelligence warranting the decision to block this crypto transactions linking it to the hashtag End Bad Governance, and they have traced more money in 4 billion naira to 3 political bigwigs across northern states where the protest was most volatile, don't you advise as well that the findings and the prosecutions be made public to re-engender trust of the system in Nigerians?
Right. I think I will take it from the spokesperson of Nigerian police. You recall it was all over the media when they actually went to Labour House to actually, you know,
raid the house, the 10th floor, second floor,
and
lobby.
What have you? And there was a back and forth that it was Labour, it was not Labour, it was people that have maybe bad business in that area. The thing is this, you know, up to now, Nigerian police has not told us who this person actually is. They only say they get some document. Why not declare these people to Nigerians? And the same thing goes to DSS. You know, most time we just hear they've arrested, they block. Look at the whopping sum of amount that they said they have, 83 billion naira. I'm sure if this is actually true and it was used for sponsor, the protest would have been more bad compared to what actually happened. So the thing is this, all this information, they should come clean. You know, once you declare somebody wanted and you have discovered some political bigwig are sponsoring such thing, you know, by the time you tame these people, shame these people, you know, it will really reduce such occurrence in future. So for us, you know, sometimes citizens will keep doubting that maybe it's just it's just to make the news, the headline. Maybe you just want us to see that you are actually are working. So sometimes you need to prove it further, because if you have blocked this cryptocurrency, you know, blocked such amount and discover these people, that bring them out, shame them, so that they will not do that next, not because of them, but the future people will have seen that, no, if you do such thing, that's what will happen. And that's the case of that person they said is in Labour House, because if you look at the way police painted that person, they don't say it's even a Nigerian crime, they say it's a global crime that he has committed. So why not, if it's global crime, disclose him and let Nigerians get to know this person. They can even help you. That's one thing people don't do. These people need to realize.
Now, let's digress a bit, but not entirely unrelated. Whilst we're told that a large number of these transactions were made using blockchain technology.
Right.
I know we had talked about it in the fintech space in our earlier discussions on the station.
Yes.
The federal government has been advised by some persons to embrace blockchain technology. The federal government has its reservations owing to previous dealings with some of such players in the Nigerian space, especially in terrorism financing.
Right.
Do you think with this occurrence of the back of the previous one, I don't want to mention the person who was arrested and detained with all whatnot, but you understand the story and where
right.
I'm going to.
Right.
Does this help the case for blockchain technology in our financial dealings in Nigeria with government approval?
Now, if you look at the current CBN, I think we have issue of policy of some sort. Because what they have approved before, they disapprove it, they bring all the bad thing. But it's, I think blockchain technology has come to stay. The only thing we need to do, and that's what we are conversing for, if CBN cannot handle the regulation, why not create an agency to regulate this blockchain technology? You remember we even saw the issue of the loan shark?
Yes.
A lot of all those things. So if CBN cannot handle it, NITDA cannot handle it. You know, it was at the point it was FCCPC that is designing the regulatory, you know, framework to actually guide. I think at this point in time, I would advise the federal government to embark on creating an agency that will look at a blockchain technology, because these people are in the cloud. And for you to monitor these people, you must be in the cloud as well.
As well.
So if the major, because if you look at the major responsibility of the CBN is, you know, is to look at the, you know, financial monetary policy, you
and
know,
regulation.
And regulation. So if this internet world view is not their big, why not create an agency that will look at this so that it will be operational and people will, that will make money will make money from it. If you want to block some part of it, you know, it's not all blockchain that are bad. If you want to block some, you block some, you know, because this blockchain will continue to work because people are very smart. Once you block this area, they open another area because it involves a lot of money in that area. Okay, having arrested the man and one of them escaped, you know, what has come after it?
People are still operating. Investigation and all that.
And we have not seen any report and people are still operating. So it's the best thing is for our advice the federal government to create an agency that will manage blockchain and even all this loan shark and what have you. Because they will keep launching and launching because the world has gone to that level. In fact, I can tell you most dealings are being paid with through blockchain. Most business, you know, they will tell you to pay through blockchain. Some days ago, I tried to check some things on. They told me that I can only pay through those blockchain technology. And I would look at it. I don't have such accounts. So how do I pay? So that means they're even using it to deny you some things so that you can actually join those areas. I think CBN need to look into it. Or federal government should create a separate agency, not even department under CBN. To actually handle it.
Well, interesting perspectives this morning as it concerns the use of blockchain technology, which has been largely one of the findings of the federal government in its evidence against the political sponsorship for the hashtag End Bad Governance protest, with over $50 million in wallets that have been traced to the sponsors. But there are more calls from Nigerians to make the arrests public and the prosecution public so that it can re-engender trust of the Nigerian populace in the system of governance. Now, and in keeping with more reviews this morning, let's also look at more calls for constitutional review. And it's from the angle of the House of Representatives that is pushing for the conduct of all elections in one day. Now, with the current capacity of our electoral umpire, INEC, is it possible? What would it imply? What would it take? Let's revisit the front page of the Nigerian Tribune where this story leads. Now, and it reads, constitutional review, reps move to reduce cost of election, pushed for conduct of all elections in one day. Now, Dr. Aliyu, Nigerians who have followed our election circles from 1999 till date have their concerns because they've been the introduction of technology to make better the process.
Right.
It has suffered reported glitches. It had worked in some off-circle elections. They had reduction in some cases of litigation after elections, but now to have all elections conducted in one day at a point when even the local government elections, many Nigerians are divided on whether the state electoral commissions as to handle it, or INEC at the federal level. How do you see these calls for constitutional reviews to have all our elections conducted in one day?
Well, I think Benjamin Kalu, the chairman of the constitutional review,
yes,
I think he has a lot of things on his table. However, it appears vague to me to come up and say all elections should be one day, because, you know, I monitor elections so much, and I saw the rigor in actually conducting that election from the perspective of INEC. You know, when you monitor election, you see that they have a lot of responsibility. And, you know, our people also are not, how do I call it, have not been educated to that level, you know. Because I recall the last election, our major problem was that there was a change in polling booth. So when you go to here, you won't see your name again. You know, they try to separate. So it makes a lot of people not to actually even vote that day, perhaps vote late in some polling booths. So I think it's a good one if you are to use it to reduce the cost of it. But if you look at off-cycle election, it's taking a whole lot. But the question is that, do we have the police? Do we have the manpower? And the major important thing that we must do before we can do that, we must unbundle INEC. You know why? If you unbundle INEC, that this, their roles are different. People that manage maybe election proper are different from people that manage the logistics itself. You know, there's a way you unbundle it, that to make it much more seamless. Then now that virtually everyone is on smartphone now, I think it's another way to actually monitor. I wrote a paper, you know, on a journal, and part of what we suggest is that there is need for us to actually
electronic voting.
There is need for it. So you only want to do, what you only need to do is that you can segment it. You know, if election is being 6 months times, you know, they can start that, you know, at a particular level. You know, it keep reducing, because as of now, Nigeria in diaspora are not even voting, and that's part of the conditionality. So I think we must unbundle INEC and make sure that electronic voting comes to stay. You can look at UK.
So if I understand you correctly,
right,
this is not entirely a bad direction.
Not at all.
But we should start with the building blocks.
Exactly.
And one of which is electronic voting. Because the judiciary in Nigeria here also go about their elections electronically.
Erufai has actually done it before. You know, during a local government election, Erufai subjected it to, you know, such voting. And he actually lost 3 local governments, you know. And for you to see that shows, it's even bring about transparency. Show me a state where they will do local government election and one opposition will take, opposition party will take maybe 2 or 1 local government. It's uhuru for the government of the day. So if you go to any state now, any local government election, it is one party that will take everything, because, you know, they have the CEC,
independent
electoral. So that's why we are also clamoring that, well, to have a local government autonomy, you must also look into local government elections. I could recall in a particular state in the southwest, the local government chairman came out and said, we don't want autonomy, we are okay with the way we are enjoying our governor. Do you imagine that at this level, and from southwest, for local government chairman to come together and said, no, we don't want autonomy? You know, it has happened in I think I watched one too in south. You know, they came out and said, no, they under the auspices of the local government chairman, they don't want autonomy, they want to also always abide with what the governors are saying. And people are suffering at the grassroots, because when they say autonomy, people are not looking at it from the grassroots perspective, because it is the local government chairman that will know, and the councilor that will know, that these people is suffering primary health care. There is no school here. We need to pay these people. And by so doing, we can even hold them accountable. But now you cannot hold local government accountable because the money is coming. Perhaps look at the politics therein now. You know, they said even the autonomy cannot start now until October. Have you seen the contradiction? Why, as judiciary passed a particular thing, Supreme Court at that level, you're now saying the implementation will start by October? What is that? It's like a gimmick for you to actually redirect what the law have just said.
Well, it's one of those conversations. I know a lot of Nigerians would agree with you upon citing some of the instances of having electronic voting work in certain local government elections. I think the earliest local government election coming up is coming up at the end of this month, starting in August, before we see other states move to have it. And now, even with the budget for the elections and the Electoral Act that was agreed upon, is the financial implications on the one hand, the I don't want to even call it manpower, because there's also the recruitment of ad hoc staff. INEC also has to suffer some logistic issues. If we look at some of these factors mitigating against having elections in one day, do you think that Nigeria is ripe as it is now, or would even be ripe in the next few election cycles for elections
when
in
we
one
even
day?
Talked about having election in one day, where we can look at it from perspective of governor. I think about nine states now is not having the same day with the presidential election. So I think that's where they can bring it. Maybe the senator, the governors, and the president, you know, if they can have that one in one. Because, you know, off-cycle election actually got up a lot of money compared to that same day. But the thing is, do we have the manpower? I want to talk about manpower. We're talking about even security itself, because it's not easy. If you look at the last election, where I monitor, you know, it was well, you know, it's not only police this time, you have even immigration. You know, even the custom, everybody will come out to actually monitor the election. But are we really mature to that level, you know? And how are you going to bring those governors? That's another judiciary issue. Because governors will say, no, you don't want me to use my actual 4 years. So how are they going to bring them together to have the election? But for me, I think it's a good one if we can actually review and see how we can manage. Because having an election in one day would have reduced a lot of cost in Nigeria.
Well, it's a question to every Nigerian in terms of what we call for constitutional review. And with the House of Reps leading the calls, it is also from the angle of the cost implication, the amount of manpower, logistics, with election materials arriving late on election day, even when we don't have all the elections on the same day. The cost of off-cycle elections, the budget for it, some of the guidelines as enshrined in the Electoral Act, to do with the transmission of results electronically, and also the ability of Nigerians in diaspora to vote electronically through e-voting. Is Nigeria ripe to have all her elections conducted in a day? It's a big question for you to answer as well. Now, in keeping with more reviews this morning, another pertinent issue is health insurance. Only a few Nigerians have the liberty of knowing what HMOs are. Many Nigerians pay out of pocket. Now, let's look at the publication by The Guardian this morning and the shocking statistics. 2 years after, states under-enroll as 90% of Nigerians still pay out of pocket. Now, we're told that the cost of healthcare has also gone up by 200% in this regard. Now, it's shocking that in a population of over 200 million Nigerians, The Guardian tells us that only 18.67 million are covered under health insurance schemes. Now, we had a national health insurance policy and the NHI Act to also ensure that Nigerians are adequately covered. What are some of the challenges you think that is excusable that 90% of our population is without health insurance at a time when we're grappling with inflation and a high cost of living?
First and foremost, I think we must start to commend the Guardian newspaper. I think
their focus always,
you know, there's a way they give statistics and they do a expository research that will bring facts. Now, let's also appreciate former President Olusegun Obasanjo. You know, when we're talking about president with policy, with, you know, innovation and whatever, I think President Obasanjo is still taking the lead. You know, during this time, he introduced what we call National Health Insurance Scheme, and the aim is to capture Nigerians. And so going forward also, if you look at President Bola Tinubu also, he bring about Minister of Health and Social Welfare. So when I saw that social welfare, I was thinking in me that, okay, this is the right time that President Bola Tinubu wants to make sure everybody have insurance cover. But it doesn't cost an arm or a leg. It costs just a policy decisions. So I think I also start with federal government. Now, if you look at federal government, most federal government workers are captured, you know, in a health insurance scheme. But if you go to state, most people in state are not that captured. Apart from that, nothing stop all Nigerians. You know, health is not what you plan for. Health, you know, when you talk about sickness, it's not what you actually plan, because you know what will befall whoever the next day. I can also tell you that I also saw the increment in purchasing of drugs, which is about 200%. I alluded to that. You know, there's this inhaler for 2,000 naira. It is now 10,200 naira. Look at the gap. Common paracetamol that we used to buy, you can see. And this is a function of even GSK. Most of them have left the country. And we don't have import substitution, we used to call it, whereby you have alternative to falling back. And I think President Tinubu has also is supporting the pharmaceutical industry to make sure that those drugs that the people that have left are producing, they can actually produce it here. So by and large, I think we need a responsive, you know, government to say that all Nigeria must be in what? In health insurance. Because if you still go to some states, people still suffer, you know, ability to involve child delivery, you know, alone. Because I recall, it's not one state, people are abusing the governor. I told them that it should be celebrating this governor. You know, after free delivery, still give them pampers or something. People now say, why is he giving them only this? I say, look at you. If you know what this simply means in the life of a mother, because there are some people that will go to deliver a child, they don't have anything. And that's what we actually lack. So I think for us to know that we are actually enjoying our democracy, it's right time for us to be under, you know, health insurance scheme. It doesn't come cheap, because to pay out of pocket. You know, remember I told you about if you are spending 60% of your income on, you know, on food, so look at the hospital bill that you don't even have plan for. And if you have a family of five, you know, the chance there that at least one person will fall sick
is very high.
It's very, very high. So where will you, you know, get that money from? And that's why we say it is very, very, and so when we have this minister, you know, and this minister is well experienced, so we expect him to have bring out a policy that will have insurance cover. You know, though most private sectors have HMO and what have you, but how many Nigerians are being covered? We have seen the statistics now, only, you know, 10%. You know, that's quite small. I think president should do something about it, especially those governors.
Now, there's a lot of calls for urgent actions in different sectors of the economy. The health sector, despite the provision for a National Health Insurance Act, still has a large number of Nigerians, more than 90% of our population, without health insurance cover. What can be done to ensure more Nigerians are captured in this brilliant initiative? Now, this is another sector that almost every Nigerian would be affected by. Telecommunication. For those who basically say, all the best I do with my phone is take calls or send messages, a lot of our financial transactions in recent times have been embedded in having telecommunication service, even if it's USSD or transactions that don't have to do with internet banking. But it's coming at a time when the telcos have been crying that even as Nigerians cry about a high cost of living, they consider there's what they call a ballooning cost of operation. This is the choice of word that the Vanguard uses to capture this story. Now, on the front page of the Vanguard, you'd find the catchphrase, ballooning operation cost. NCC stakeholders kick as telcos threaten service outage. Now, the Business Times says, telecoms, why tariff hike is an absolute necessity, says MTN CEO. You have discussed this earlier. You looked at the angle of the licenses most of them are operating with.
Right.
Some of the servicing of their equipment with importation of things. They have to do with dollarization as well.
Right.
The House of Legislatives are the ones that have stood in the process of this hike. If not, I think it would have come earlier. At the time we're having, what's the hike that was dropped? If you can remind me.
Yes, the licensing.
Exactly. Let's get your thoughts again.
Right. Honestly, to be candid with you, if there's a sector that is very, very important to the backbone of Nigerians and Nigerian government, I think it's telcos. And they have been doing well. Recall that about 11 years ago, up to now, they have not had a change in the tariff difference. And they also purchase diesel at the same rate. And if you look at all their masts, you know, they have to like service it and what have you. And they also suffer tax, double taxation, you know. Local government will collect from them, state will collect, federal government will also collect from them. So at this point in time, honestly, if they increase the tariff, I'm part of people that will say, well, it's well deserving, because they are also operating the same business environment where fair subsidy removal have taken place. So for me, I think government need to come to their aid in the area of maybe supporting them. If they don't want them to increase tariff, they need to support them or give them some tax relief. You know, maybe with that tax relief, they will be able to really balance, because it's not actually easy. And they have come to liberate a lot of things in Nigeria. Like rightly mentioned, our financial operation, most of us don't go to four-wall bank anymore. We just go to our phones and do what we want to do. And a lot of bill that we pay online is a function of effective telecommunication. So if you ask me, I think government need to come to their aid, because this is what they are saying is quite necessary. Even look at all other products and other services, they have increased their pay. Even our data and what have you still remain the same as it was. So I think government need to come to their aid or they do it marginally. You know, there's a way that you do marginal increments that will actually not really affect Nigerian Damo. But I think it's a necessary thing that they need to look into very, very well.
Well, at this point of the program, we just have a few more papers to gloss through, and we'll be back to take those line up. Three more papers with what the front pages are saying in terms of getting perspective and also starting conversations online. But let's take a quick commercial break. When we return, we'll look at these papers as we conclude our local newspaper review. Stay with us. Well, thanks for staying with us on the show this morning. The wet seasons in Nigeria come in full circle, and whilst August this year, there's not an August break in sight. Now, quite sadly so, it's a mixed deal. Farmers, agri experts are happy yields are looking to improve. There are issues concerning flood emergencies, but another issue of concern is the safety of our roads during the wet season. The Lagos-Ibadan Expressway has now become a very bad spot in terms of a recurrent accident on that spot. Now, the Daily News Hub is one of the papers this morning that looks at that in terms of a lead story. We'll look at it as we look at the perspectives of Dr. Aliyu as well. Now, in picking the Daily News Hub again, just to remind our viewers, you'd find the lead story, tragedy in Ibadan, 16 killed, 17 injured as trailer crushes vehicles. Now, and, some of those visuals we can't share with our viewers because it's quite gory.
Right.
But when you look at the death toll, an accident that can claim 16 persons, even if it's in a 16-seater bus, and injure 17 persons, we hear some of those children lost their parents. But residents speaking to the media are saying that this is a recurrent spot. On this same spot, it keeps happening. The government of the day has been urged to expedite actions, but it's more from a challenge that many say we should be able to plan for, owing to the fact that it has happened year in, year out. What's your take on this development?
I think our ministry, Minister of Works and the ministry must take note of what we call incident tracking. You know, when an incident happened one place, you know, it's very bad that it happened 3, 4, 5 times and it continues like that. Because if you look at this issue now, that means that same spot has become a serious problem. You could have a good road, but there will be bad construction in a particular place, or there will be major pothole or problems. I think the authority need to do something. And that's why we have FEMA, you know, Federal Road Maintenance Agency. How well are they doing this? So, and we are calling on government to actually do something meaningful. But another thing is this, you know, when President Muhammadu Buhari come about, you know, having our train and what have you, we are happy that, okay, by now that simply means most of these trailers will reduce on the road and we'll have all these goods, all this consignment passing through the to the rail. That is the expectation. But we have Lagos Ibadan, you know,
cargo rail,
working now. But what it will be very beautiful, the way President Bola Tinubu said that we have Sokoto, you know, to Lagos. You know, when you have all those one interstate train working, there will be
decongest
the road and whatever. So I think this is the level we need to go through. And that's why we need to expedite all those. And that's why some of the loans that federal government are collecting, we are always expecting them to do a project tied loan that will solve this problem. In a year, we can fix all these things. So I think FEMA need to do something. And I must commend the Nigerian road safety. You know, if there's any sector that are actually doing very, very well, it's Nigerian road safety. When there's any incident, they get there on time and do their... But we don't even want them to be working. You know, where we have free, good road, where we don't have where we have accident-free, there will be less work for them to actually do on the main road. So I think federal government needs to do more, and FEMA needs to be very... Go to all these federal roads that have issues. Please fix it for us so as to make sure that the trailer and small car clashes reduces to a greater level.
Owing to time, this is as much as we can take on our local newspaper review, but I must extend our gratitude as always for taking our time to critically analyze issues in the news. We appreciate you.
Thank you for having me.